Hello everyone, and today again we are discussing PMP and we have Haseeb with us and he has some questions. He is going to give his PMP exam soon. Now before we get into the PMP related questions, why don't Haseeb you introduce yourself and then we take the conversation forward.
So my name is Haseeb Ahmed and I'm from Pakistan and I belong to a construction site, a construction projects, and I have been through in construction projects since 2015, so it makes 4 years, so it's not more or not less. 4 years has got some potential. So I have been dealing directly or indirectly with the construction project. I'm not
No, it's great. Watch. Yeah, so there was some electricity issue, so that's for a while. Yeah, it is. Yeah, okay. Like that. Yeah.
So I have been directly or indirectly leading or directing or part of it to the projects, construction projects. You know, construction projects are very complex in natures. You have got plenty of interfaces in construction projects. So that was my intro. And if you want to know about my PMP journey, so I have started my journey on March 23rd. It's been 6 months.
Good. So I'm hoping that you will finish it now. It's been a while.
The
great.
fact is, initial 3 months, I was having zero direction. I was just aiming through the PIM box and just go to the knowledge area, read it, next knowledge area, read it, next. And then I thought that I have to go to the, I have to schedule the exam and give it the exam. But somebody told me that no, either way you will lose your money or waste your money. So somehow I have met with Rita Book and I remember I used to map the Rita's process with my real world project management thing. I used to go to the sites, construction sites, used to questioning others, used to questioning my seniors, and somehow built some roadmap.
Great. That, yeah.
What is the project management in the PMI and PMP concern is all about.
So, perfect.
Come to the stats which I have been done as far as the tests are concerned. I want to share it with you so that you can tell me where I am.
No, I did looked at your results and all, scores and all.
Okay.
See, they all are good. Like in general, they all are good. There is no issue with that.
My one concern is your in your resources, in your free resources, free PMP resources in your Eisenbilt's website. There's a FabMark 200 full length test, second last or last one. That was a very real kind of scenario. The question in one window, then you select next, and the very real time simulator, you can say. And after that, they had provided me a certificate also with the closing above target and rest of the processes target. But when I have seen the percentage, I have got a disappointment that 69% the percentage I had at that time. But I don't know where they picked me up, like the targets in rest of the areas and above target in closing. I don't know.
So what I'm saying,
60% threshold level.
Yeah, probably. So what I'm saying is, don't worry about that. The only essence is that what you learned from it. So for example, the essence should be like you could not do 30% of the questions, and what probable reasons you find might be contributing to that. See, any practice test, they tell you a percentage number or give you above target, below target. It is just an indicative. Primarily, the real exam is going to be having little vague standard for percentage. And you need to just focus on that. Okay, I know what I'm doing and I know where I'm making mistakes. So probably I can improve it. That's it. So by 60-65%, if you start getting that idea that, okay, these remaining 30-40% are going wrong because of ABC. And that is something we can discuss that, okay, what if you have a visibility about that, then perfect. You can just fix it.
But after giving the Oliver 100 and 200 questions, what I have scored is 74% in 100 Oliver and 200 full length is 72%. That's when I got some potential that because there is a mainstream topic that Oliver tests are much difficult one as compared to the others.
Yeah, but that not necessarily contribute the direct way. Because the real exam may not come in a similar way. Again, it's a good benchmark to see how well you have prepared your content. It's a good benchmark. Mm-hmm. But the real questions will be more situational, less tricky the way it is. It's not about that you put some jargon here and since the person doesn't understand that jargon, he end up making it wrong. But yeah, again, each test serves a purpose. It gives you a kind of a readiness information. My recommendation will be again that what is not working, you should be knowing the reasons. Sometimes you can say, oh, this was little term issue. This term I was not aware. That's why I could not make it good. Or you understand that looks like this question has little confusing options and I don't agree with it. Then also it's okay. Or you correct your thinking process that, okay, based on this question, I understand my thinking process is going little wrong here and I need to correct it. So that is how we need to take these exam feedbacks.
But sir, after analyzing my exam, what I figured out is, oh, I was just short that. I know this terminology behind that, but I was just short to select the right one. But that is not the way that I come up with the answer and feel that, oh, where it comes from. But I have pretty much idea about that this should be the answer, why I should not have been done that.
Good.
So it's a little bit difference.
Yeah.
So by picking the C as compared to the D.
Okay. So great. So how do you fix that? That when you are making these small differences, what can help you in fixing that?
Help you is kind of just a minor level. You can say, let's start with my 7 points agenda which I have been
mentioning. Good. Yeah, let's start with it.
So I have the first point is that phase versus process group. I have been noticing much difficulties in it, but now I think I am to the point that what is the difference between phase versus process group? For example, in a construction project, you have got first phase of feasibility report, in which you assess the needs, your strategies, and all that things. So, for that feasibility report phase, at the end of the phase gate, you will have the feasibility report, which will have to be validated by our stakeholders and anybody which is involving in that fair. So, as far as the deliverable is concerned, so why not the project manager hired from the start? Why he hired from the project charter, the inputs of the project charter is business documents. So he joins the project after the rest of the bodies completed the business documents. Why he not in the previous phase?
Okay, so it depends upon how the organization's business models are. What I am hearing from you is that in a particular organization, what you are observing is there is a separate group of people who runs a feasibility study. And to me, it looks like a small project where they pick up the idea, they plan it, and based on that, they do an execution, they run their own monitoring and control, and at the end, their project finishes when they produce a feasibility report. Now, based on that output, some stakeholder decides that we want to go with the project or not go with the project. And when they see go with the project, they initiate the separate project. So the charter for separate project is executing or really implementing what has been recommended as a feasibility study report. Now, these two projects could be one project in some cases where you have little, and you might be observing in some of the cases they are one where maybe you got the Without feasibility study itself, you got an approval. Maybe some government project is there, or maybe some old customer is coming again back with you. And they say, just go ahead with it and we will check if it is feasible or not in between. But more or less looks like it is going to work. Now, when you have a more confidence that this is going to work, I have already bought the land and I have everything is like this. We may need to change the design if it doesn't work, but we will go ahead with it. There is less possibility that we will not go ahead with it at all. In those cases, the project manager may get involved. They may organize the whole thing as a one project rather than keeping two things as a separate projects.
In Create WBS process, if you see, there's a main project is value management system project. And under it, there's a 1.1 WBS, the phase level. Second level is a phase level. And there is a needs assessment, but they are clearly mentioning here the WBS is illustrative only. It is not intended to represent the full product scope to any specific body. I think the needs assessment is not the part of, it's part of the WBS, but it's not like open to everyone.
Yeah, so that is what I am telling, that you take this thing as an example, because there could be a possibility in some project, need assessment is part of it. So you may have an opportunity to work in a project where you also do need assessment first and then you take it forward. Say in a, let's take an example. If there is an existing building and they want to improve the layout and some parking space and something which they just want to improve. Now what they say is that, okay, talk to my guys and see that how my current infrastructure is helping them and what kind of issues they have. And based on those issues, come up with the options and implement it. So you got a charter that, okay, talk to my, say, assuming this is a business mall, and in a mall, you need to do this. So they say, talk to my people and understand what is not helping them. So you do a need assessment where you are primarily collecting their pains. And according to the assessment of the pains, you come up with the one or two feasible options. And then you say, okay, we can change the parking layout like this. We can change the some part of the building like this. And this is in this particular project, need assessment was part of it.
So, okay, if project manager is handling all the phases, then project management plan should be at the start.
True. So the idea is, one thing is
project schedule also.
Yeah. So
it is depicting the deliverables that feasibility study report will be delivered on this date.
And idea is that these plans get planned and elaborated as you go along. So, and that is why the phase and process groups are different. So when you are in a feasibility phase, then you do planning for the feasibility phase. You do a monitoring and control for a feasibility phase. It might happen.
That's why your monitoring and controlling curve starts from the scratch and ends at the end.
Yeah. And as soon as you are moving towards the closure of a feasibility phase, you are planning for the execution or a first level pilot one may get started. Something like that. Yeah.
So, sir, that's very logical. That's very understandable. So, in this way, also the scope statement and collect requirement is also progressively elaborated. And once in the first iteration, you have got this much of scope, and after that, while review meeting with the stakeholders, you have got more scope and more collect requirements, and then scope statement, and then all that things.
Yeah. So, in order to understand that the progressive elaboration and adaptive part in your construction industry, start thinking from 2-3 perspective. One perspective could be that you need to develop a township, but the whole township will go into multiple phases. So it's not like that the whole township get once, but your project is given for the whole township. So you may do an initial layout planning and sewage and all those things in a one go, but then you identify one area which goes in construction, and based on their experience, you may also change the part of it. Yeah.
Okay.
So it is like the same project is going on, but it is going into a multiple progressive elaboration. The another thing you can think in your construction industry is that maybe you are building one apartment, and apartment has kind of a blocks. They don't create rooms. They just create blocks, and initially they just create boxes. And after that, customer comes and they decide they want to make 2 rooms, 3 rooms, 4 rooms, 5 rooms. So there is a flexibility. And based on that, later, in between.
Yes, I am here. I think there was a communication noise.
I know. So let me repeat again. So when I was saying that in the construction projects, what you can think is that you can think like one is a township, the example which we were exploring. The another example you can explore is like a creating an apartment, which doesn't create the rooms in apartment. You just create multiple floors and you create boxes. But later on, the customer can choose how he wants to put up the layouts. So then you do a progressive planning, clear-cut progressive planning. The first planning is just creating boxes. And then second, you have an agreement. Maybe as soon as the buyer buys it later on, the particular section, then you get a more layout. You give them options. They may have a customization and then you build it out. So such kind of project can help you to think about changing and progressive planning in a better way.
Yes. So in relation with that, I have encountered one question that the question was depicting that you are a project manager and you are dealing with the customer and customer is handing over you a statement of work and meanwhile sponsor giving you the project charter and you have done with the project management plan. Okay, you have done with the project manager plan. So after that, in some scope statement and collect requirement review meeting, some of the stakeholder pointed out to the project manager that I think you are not gonna make it 100%. So the options, question describe what should the project manager do in that kind of scenario. Two options I have skimmed through the two options that one option said that that go back and do the collect requirement thing, okay, and second option that start with the change request and the formal change process. So what I figured out that the question was not mentioned about the that you are in executing, because once you are in executing you have plan something, and once you are doing something, so you have to, if you want to change something, then you have to go with the process. And it also depends on your change management plan and configuration management plan. What items are configurable or what items are not. It is much deeper in that. So the correct answer was that go back and do the requirement and scope thing again with the stakeholders. So what I have figured out that yet the baselines are not have not been done and all. So that question was very not much elaborative.
Sure. So what I'm seeing it here is maybe the question itself has its own issues, but let's see.
Believe a 200 question.
Yeah, possible. It could have some issues, but let's see what is the context here. So the context is that you have a project management plan. Now, as soon as you say that you have a project management plan, it means you have a scope. By default, you can assume the statement of work is a part of project management plan by default, until unless it is telling that you just have a draft project management plan or something. Because the project management plan get initiated very early in the project development, even before you have a statement of work. But statement of work, WBS, and project schedule are part of a project management plan. So if the question gives you an indication that you have a project management plan, you can fairly assume that it was planned, baseline stuff, and now you are having a conversation. Now, when you are having a conversation, some stakeholder raises an issue. Now, it is not necessarily that you jump and work on change request, because the stakeholder is not, in your explanation, is not giving you a requirement. It is just making a comment. Now, comment may help you to do some risk analysis that, okay, I have got this comment. Does this comment really adds value, or I don't have to worry about it? So it is possible that you treat that comment as an input and then you do your own due diligence and accordingly you decide what you should do about it. So it may result into revalidating the requirement. It may result into identifying the right stakeholder. It might be possible the stakeholder who is making comment right now is not involved in requirement. So you understand that I have done mistake in stakeholder identification itself. Now I involve the stakeholder and I do the whole process again. So that is more important. Yeah.
If you are in executing and you are intending to go back, you have to have some buy-in in it and resource in it. So isn't kind of a cost impact thing? So somebody is there and again elaborating and collecting the requirements and then progressively elaborating them.
Possible.
Doesn't need to change the question.
Yeah. It may. So, for example, that you are building a building and you were about to go ahead with your execution and somebody raised a comment, looks like that your building will not comply with the urban standard placed in this area. Now, what do you do? Then you say, okay, is it so? Then let me check it out. And then you may spend time in understanding the urban standards again. And you say that this guy has raised this comment. And it may results into that, okay, we don't have a legal guy with us and we are going ahead without validating the compliances. And if we keep doing it, we will be in a mess. Then you may need a change request where you tell that, okay, but this is a later stage. Once you realize that, yes, this is a problem. And then you say, okay, I need a legal guy included in my team. That's the one thing. The another thing is that looks like that we are doing something which is not compliant. We need to rework. And it may result into a rework as well. But you can't just say that it will be reworked or it will not be reworked till the time you take that comment and do some your own due diligence to identify that how deep that comment is.
Okay. So I have seen your couple of videos and what I have found out from that initiating and closing process groups have substantially do with the PMP because it has got only one and two processes. Initiating has got two and closing has got one. So what is your suggestion for initiating and closing?
What I see is initiating is primarily project charter and identify stakeholders. And identify stakeholder is a little bit tricky. It is not that straightforward. Things like the question you were discussing, it might fall under identification of stakeholder itself because you might have missed identifying.
You missed identify the stakeholders.
Yes. So I do recommend practicing more questions related to that process group area. Getting into little details of the reasons why something is right and why something is wrong, maybe beyond what is written in PMBOK. And the closing is the another dangerous process because most of the project managers are, in general, poor in closing. So what they do is they finish something and they get over with something else. And in general, I see that the experience of closing is really lacking, you know. So until unless you are working in a very mature organization where you can't move next till the time your project is properly closed, especially people.
Or you are just intelligent enough to just grasp the knowledge which PMBOK is telling you.
Yeah. So because of that missing experience, sometimes people find it difficult to relate to the questions. And that's why you need to spend more time thinking about closing. Especially when somebody is working with the in-house projects where you have a big department and you do one project and after that next. So there is a possibility that before your first project finishes, the second project is already get started. And as soon as some level of closing starts happening in a first project, you are busy doing second. And this may remain lingering for long. So spend more time focusing on that closing related content, why it is important. Always keep in mind that closing is anyway needed, even if project get terminated in between, even if the customer cancels it, even if it was a failure. Whatever it is. So that's the another interesting thing because we usually don't understand even when the customer is canceling the order, why I have to close the project. I just better go on and start working on something else. But in a PMBOK understanding, closing is putting it to the end and finally consolidating its end status. So whenever somebody wants to resume, they can just look at it and get started with.
Yes. So as far as the closing is concerned, suppose you are handing over the deliverable to the stakeholder or the customer, and they have validated it interimly, on the interim basis. But while formal acceptance, while final formal acceptance, they mention you out that I am not happy with this. Please change it. Okay. So if you know that the customer is demanding a change, because ultimately he is the boss of the, he is the product owner, he is boss of it. So you are suddenly go to the you do the impact analysis on your own, and then you just give it to the perform integrated chain control, to the CCB, that they do the business impact analysis kind of thing. Because as a project manager, you do the impact analysis via integration, by like risk, cost, resources, schedule. But in as far as the umbrella of CCB, they do the business kind of impact analysis. Are they aligning with the business and kind of stuff? So if that change requirement from the customer at that closing point where you are thinking about to just close the project up, so it's good to have the change request and that analysis.
Definitely. See, there are two aspects to it. As a good project manager, you should target to do progressively scope validation. So you keep doing, as you finish a deliverable, a validation of scope, you call do a validate scope. So in a construction, you can think of as the first sample flat get ready, you take the approval from the stakeholders that, okay, does this flat look good? As the lifts gets ready, you take a, okay, is the lifts looking good? As the parking space get designed, you take an approval for, is the parking space looks good? So you keep collecting those signature, the lightings, the parks, and everything, you keep collecting it. Now, finally, when the whole apartment is ready and you saying that, okay, we all have these approvals and you have been getting involved in the design as well as an execution stage, and then you are presenting that final thing. Now, the person, when you are doing this, the customer say, you know, everything is looking good. But finally, when I look at now, looks like the overall the parking space is not like the color or the painting on the paints on the parking space is not matching with the building ethics overall. So I think there has to be better alignment between overall color scheme of the building and the parking space color scheme of the building. Now, that's a comment, though you have taken an approval and everything, and that's a comment has been come. Now, what do you do with it? So it depends upon what is your contract, how these kind of changes are taken care, if these changes are explicitly mentioned, and what kind of a relationship you want to maintain with that customer. Now, that is why it's not the customer who takes the decision, it's the sponsor who takes the decision. So your company, who is a building for that particular client, may decide to observe the cost and say it's just a paint color, just do it. Yeah, why to take it? Because we want to do a lot of business with these guys, even if at the last says, let's do it. So they may approve the change request. Now, if the person starts asking little more structural changes, that he says, you know, now the cars are not fitting well, and you know, your pillars are coming in between. And now you find it very difficult to do a realignment of pillars, because it is not a painting, it's a pillars. And overall, whatever it is, that the flow of parking, the way it has been discussed, now he's thinking of changing the exit point. And he says, no, the exit from here is a little risky. I want to change the exit point from here to there. Now, in order to do that, you see there are a lot of issues and there are structural changes, and some of the changes are very like not feasible because the building, whole building is standing on it.
They
some of
the changes, cost and, yeah. And you ultimately rework it like 100% rework.
Yeah. So now, but some of the changes are possible. So in those cases, again, it goes to a change control board, and you see what can be done. But there is a possibility that. There is a real possibility that customer was thinking of exit in a one direction, but later on the urban authority rejected that idea. And he was thinking of going exit in that direction, but now it's not possible. For him also, it's not possible. And he's saying, we need to change the exit. Now, you understand there is a need, but you also understand there is a constraints. So it's a joint exercise. You says, okay, I understand you have I appreciate your need. But both of us missed it because you never told that the overall assumption was we will go in that way. But later on, you are saying, no, this is not allowed now. We have a different business model now. So you go with something else. So
on the other hand, if customer is asking to change something which is not mentioned in the scope baseline, but he is pretty much into it and say to you, just done it. So what is the course of action?
So is you it share
change request or just list in the lesson learned for the future projects?
No. You definitely both the things. Okay. See, the idea here is now when we are talking about parking change and all, so the one thing is that we need to take care of it. The future lesson learned is not only rely on what customer is saying, also take a little bit more step forward and understand overall urban laws and bring this as a risk if the customer is not aware about it. So you may start taking into consideration that I should have looked into the design of nearby buildings and nearby areas to understand that whatever customer was asking is not allowed. Though he's insisting on it, but it's not allowed. So that could be a lesson learned. But the change which you both of you suffered, sponsor as well as the customer, is something you have to do based on understanding. So there is no right and wrong. There is no rejection or acceptance.
It's rational to say that while you are closing the project and when you look up your baseline and the customer, what he is demanding is not in the baseline. So you have to incorporate in the baseline via change request.
Possible. So it is not necessary changing the baseline. See, when do you change a baseline? Baseline is primarily a monitoring tool because you want to measure
your project.
Yeah, it's a reference. Now, sometimes you are at a closing stage, you don't want to change the reference. You want to say that we close the project with 50% variance. You don't want to change that. You say, yeah, we want to, yeah, there is a change request, we are accepting it, but the reference remains the same and we will close it with a 50% thing. But you have to
do according to the customer via change request.
Yeah, so you have
it's to... It's safer to pick the change request in that kind of scenario.
Yes.
It's safer to pick.
So rather than do, you can say that you need to present the option to the stakeholders for a given requirement. So somebody says change it. So you need to do your feasibility analysis and present the options that, okay, by changing, we delay the project by this much date and this much time. By not changing, you have a possibility of launching your project and earning money by selling shops in your mall. Now, which one do you want to take? You want to wait for a few more months or you want to sell your shops now?
Okay. So, sir, I have figured out that another substantial portion, which is I think pretty much above than 50%, is executing. Mm-hmm. You have got multiple process groups in it. So, and my favorite knowledge area is resource one, because in daily life I have to do all kind of things. So, starting from acquire team, and then develop, and then manage team. So, what is the probability, and what is the percentage level, the questions, the PM at the PFP, real time questions?
It's difficult to tell. General, we do feel 20-25 questions are easy to come from human resource related area. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Exactly which particular process group. Sometimes it's very difficult to recognize also because they are mixed in multiple terms. So yeah, but that much is a fair assumption. And yeah.
So in managed team context, if you are dealing with the conflict management, and I have a question, that conflict should be resolved openly or just privately with that person with he is creating the conflict, or just sit with everybody and deal with the conflict? Because conflict, I have seen your videos, you have said that conflict should be discussed openly.
Yeah, see, what is the issue is, you can't get a very definitive answer for it, and you can't predict how the PMP exam is going to take it. Now, because the questions are not necessarily coming based on PMBOK in these kind of cases, and PMBOK is not saying anything about it, and it is based on how generally people do. So it is difficult to say how actually the exam will look into conflict management, but there are a few things which are guiding. One of the thing is that the best way to resolve conflict is the people who are in conflict, they should resolve it. Yes. So that's something we can keep in mind. And the another thing we can keep in mind is it's better if people can acknowledge and appreciate the conflict and handle it. So it's more like a problem solving. You are doing it in open space. Until unless it's a very sensitive issue where people just... So there could be few conflicts which get escalated if done in open, because people take it personally. Like, okay, how if I feel attacked, and especially I feel attacked in front of many people, I may go into a more escalated level of conflict rather than reducing it. But if I there is a healthy interactions happening, then it might be good to resolve the issue in the open so that there is less confusion. I don't know what the deal these guys have made. Oh, you didn't say this in front of me. I don't know what you are saying in front of them. So those kind of confusions can come. So when you see that there is some level of foundational belief, there is a little healthy environment, then I do feel doing it in open resolves some future speculations. But when there are two sensitive issues, then you may want to settle down in isolation for a while. And final resolution, it may happen in the open only. So the way you can say smoothing can happen in private areas. So once smoothing is done, which is, again, you are deferring the overall conflict resolution, but you are smoothing the environment to get people ready.
It's just like that you see the burning thing, you just smooth. And then after smoothing, then they people are very much tend to listen to you.
Yes. So, and then you may do a problem solving in open. Yeah. Then yes. You may bring all the people to all the people who are in
problem solving or compromising.
Yeah. Yeah. So it can happen in open. Yeah. It can happen. In
okay.
Open. So it's more transparent communication rather than hidden. Yeah.
Okay. So I have got pretty much idea about the managed quality and what is the difference between managed quality and control quality. So in control quality, you are more about the correctness of the deliverable or the document which you will be delivering towards the customer. It's more about the correctness. And when you do the managed quality, you translating the quality thing in your activities.
Perfect. So you can say that when you are doing control quality, you are ensuring that my team has done something, but I want to make sure my customer should not get faulty things. So you put an extra layer. You say, my team has done something. Let me check it out before I give it to the customer. So that is the attitude there. Whereas managed quality is focusing on, let's do the quality work so that we don't fail. So that there is no rework. So when we are working, we work in such a way so that we always meet quality. That's the focus. But even after doing everything, you may want to have an extra layer that, okay, whatever happened, let's make sure the customer doesn't get the faulty product.
I have seen in Rita that they showed there that in managed quality, you also take something from the control quality to just assess where we went wrong and then just do according to what a new strategy would be. So we are in managed quality or still in control quality? Because doing in that way.
So again, I will take the building example, and you are creating flat by flat, floor by floor. So you are done with the first floor, and first floor is done and the first apartment is ready. And then you do a control quality there and you realize that there are some issues before you give it to the customer, validate scope, before you invite the customer to see the flat, you realize that there are some issues. And then you realize that the material which is getting used is not sticky enough or is not the appropriate enough as per the quality standards. Now you want to change that material for the upcoming floors. So what you have done is, when you were doing a control quality for the first floor, you realize that there is something which is not working out. So this goes back as a feedback to your plan and manage that, okay, going forward. So for the next floor, you want to make sure that we have learned from the previous floor during control that let's not use this material anymore, or let's use it in a different way.
Act accordingly.
Act accordingly.
And so when you are acting, you are in managed quality.
Yeah. So it is not like the sequential process. It might be a sequential.
PMP is just like that. You are here and suddenly something happens, you are here. Mm-hmm. You are in next process, yeah. next process.
True. But so, it is for the next deliverable, or it is for the next thing. Obviously. So it, for a building, each floor could be a deliverable for you, which you do a validate scope. And once you are done with the first floor control quality, you get a feedback for the second floor. Then you improve. So don't think like that everything is happening in a sequence, because the progressive elaboration is happening. Something is still getting planned. Maybe the upper floors are still getting planned. Yeah.
So let's put some light on issue log. Issue is log created when we are dealing with the people more and the stakeholders.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they are more, and I think the plan stakeholder management, the input is issue log and change log more. It's kind of people thing. Issue log is kind of people thing.
So anything which is an issue, say I have an issue with the report, I have an issue with your working times, I have an issue. So it is not necessarily a change. I just want to say, I don't like the guys, you the report you guys sent. Now, it could be that I need to understand the person doesn't understand it. It's an educational problem. Or I want to understand that it requires a different report, or he's not an appropriate person to get this report because I am sending a technical report to a non-technical guy. So there could be a three possible resolution. But when the person calls me and says, I don't like these reports, I don't understand them. Now, that's an issue. Now you got an issue that my stakeholder called me and he said that he doesn't understand the report. Now, the resolution could be multiple. And some of the resolution may lead to a change request that, okay, it's a change request. Let's remove this guy from the communication plan, or let's change the report so that he starts understanding it. It could be anything.
Okay, so I have got one thing. If stakeholder requests to change the frequency of updates and progress reports, and communication management plan in question, there is written that the communication management plan is widely interpreted. What should the PM do? And the option would be, if communication plan is widely interpreted, then you don't need to change the communication plan. I have encountered one question and
the essence here is that you have a communication management plan and person is saying that rather than monthly report, I need a weekly report. Then what do you do? Is this the thing? Now, it again depends upon your overall change control thing. It may require a change request. It may not require a change request. Now, we need to appreciate why it might require a change request, because the preparation of that report might be a lengthy process. It might require compilation of data from multiple departments. Now, in a project scope, you discuss that this report will be presented once in a month. Now, and the presentation may happen in a meeting room. Now, if somebody says, no, I need a weekly meeting, then I need to prepare and I need to arrange my people going there and presenting it weekly. So, which will be a significant cost for a project team. In some cases, sometimes these reports are presented in a different location. So just, I want to make people appreciate that there is a possibility that such a change in a frequency results into a significant change in a cost. So don't just think of, oh, what if he wants again? Yeah, it is not that simple in some projects. It could be that simple in some other project. He says, I already have an information. I have been clicking button send report once in a month. I can click it every week. Yeah, okay. In those cases, he says, okay, I agree and we will go ahead with it. So without following a proper change process.
Okay, so that's very nice. And rest of the process groups are in executing is implement risk responses, conduct procurements, and manage stakeholder engagement. So if you're done with the responses, plan responses, if you're done with the plan responses, what next? Next should be controlling, because the implementation part would be handling direct and managed project work.
Yeah.
Because risk register, updated risk register goes there, and then we'll be translating the work while mitigating or...
Yeah, so in a risk management, now we didn't had this implement risk response before. it was clearly left into executing process group of project integration management till PMBOK 5. But in PMBOK 6, they started using the term implement risk response separately. And now it creates a possibility of that whenever while you are working on risk, if you see a risk, you do this process. So earlier, it was that whenever you see a risk, you follow your executing process because already there is a plan, you implement it. So when you are done with your planning of risks, you do execution and you monitor risk triggers. Whenever risk trigger occurs, you go to implement risk responses, and that is the process you continue with. So and control risk is more about you reflect on how the risk management process is working. Okay, was our plan good enough? Our contingencies
identify new risks
and identify the effectiveness of risk response management or a risk response planning.
Watch list and low probability risks.
Yeah.
Multi kind of control risk. So come to the monitoring and controlling. I think there's a major thing is validate and control quality in control monitoring and controlling, and then control scope, control communication, control procurement, monitor risk. And so we have no idea about the questions which will be coming in the exam, because my exam is on 28th of September. It's probably a Saturday.
I think it's a good preparation. So what is making you worried about controlling thing?
Frankly speaking, I don't think so. I have got any problem with controlling, but still it's a confidence problem.
Yeah, nothing like that.
So I must say.
Good amount of controlling questions will be linked to change request. That's it.
Change request.
Yeah, and then there will be few, now earlier it used to be more, few linked to earned value management. And few linked with, it's more about work performance data, work performance report, and variance analysis, different types of variance analysis. So that's the major portion of controlling. So when do you do that variance analysis? So change is the biggest topic there. So when do they change request, how to handle it, and all those things. So 5-7 questions will go there itself, and rest are spread across other monitoring and control processes. Yeah.
Okay, so it's time to give me a formal acceptance. So how did you assess me? Are you sure that I'm pretty much confident in alignment with the PMI strategy, PMI parts and PMP thoughts?
I do see there is a very high probability of
would I tell the PMP or not?
Sure. So that's what I'm telling. There is a high probability of you making it, because I have been seeing your interactions as well. So you already have an understanding of how the PMBOK should process it. You already started mapping your real life processes to the PMBOK processes, and that is something I keep advising to practitioners, because it's not about memorizing it. It's all about visualizing and understanding it. And I think the confusion, which was more about the phase and process, which was coming again and again by way of sequence between monitoring and managing and all those things, also I hope got clarified here. So with that, that's the only thing which I feel was not clear enough from your interaction as well as on the YouTube as well as here. And I hope that is pretty good now. So should not face any problem.
So I should have been purchased your program if I would have to know that.
That's not an issue. We do many other programs as well.
I must say that after clearing my PMP, I must join the ACP program.
I know. Great.
ACP or CSM, you can say, what you will be saying.
Sure. So our goal remains is helping you guys in moving your career ladder.
So for ACP, the prerequisites should be and remains to clear the PMP first. Then.
Yeah. So let's not confuse right now. I think it's a clear cut. Okay. You are very ready for the PMP, and there is a lot of journey to come. There are multiple programs. So as you want to grow in your career, you may want to do few things more. But as of now,
I want to say, is it early in that I have got 4 years of experience only, and I'm going to crack.
I think it's a good starting point. It's a good starting point. There is nothing early. So we do have like Siba. I used to speak.
Yes, I have. Yeah,
she is also, I think, more or less on the same space. So she was also a little concerned about her experience and all. So more or less on the same space. It's all depend like how you want to structure your career. There are people who want to do little more professional experience. There are people who want to do experience more and ignore the certification for a later stage. So there is nothing right and wrong. Since you have taken this path, I'm sure in next 10 days you get this path done.
One more thing. As far as the time endurance is concerned, I have done 3 full length mocks till now. And in 3 full time 10 mocks, I have completed up the whole 200 question in 3 hours and 10 minutes.
It's good. So just try to keep doing it towards the final week as well, when you are going through your final week of preparation, because the only thing is that you don't feel tired. That's it. There is nothing about even if you are doing running for 2 hours, after 1 hour, you start feeling irritated. And if you have to run for 2 hours after 1 month, better you try it running for 2 hours sometime before so that you know how it starts feeling after 1 hour. So when you run the final day, you know how it's going to feel. So in the same way, you want to prepare yourself to talk about how it's going to look like or feel like so that I'm ready. That's it.
So, sir, one or two line tip you are trying to
say. I think you are perfectly doing it. Yeah, as usual, as I said, just try to focus on what do you next. So try to visualize the process, be it more clear how things are going on. Whenever you feel little challenging question, try to map the question to a process. Okay, out of 49 processes, this process is looks like is more appropriate here. So as soon as you can map the process, the things will become more clear to you, because then you can easily pick up the choice. So not necessary you do this for all the questions, because there are a few questions which you can just see and understand it. But whenever you feel more challenge, you can start mapping it to a process, and that can help you to find.
So right now the trend is every question is what do you do next kind. Every question is just like that or some kind.
No. There will be few, not every, but there will be many such questions as well. So the idea here is that the sooner you can, whenever you get confused, you can map the question to a process that, okay, looks like I'm in a process ABC. As soon as you know process ABC, you have a visibility. What kind of a things you might have done before, what kind of things you might do later, and what might be you are already engaged in. So your process definition comes in your head. So keep the definition of all the 49 processes very clear in your mind, and understand 102 output, the main output which comes out of those processes all the time in your mind, that, okay, if this is the process, this is what we are doing here. This is what we are trying to achieve there. That's it. If you have that, I think rest your theory and all, you have already done well.
Sir, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'll keep touching you, inshallah. I'll keep touching you.
Sure, thank you. Sure. It was nice talking to you, Asif. Yeah. Bye.